Welcome, Pat. Thank you very much for joining me for tea. Would you like a cup of tea?
Yes, please.
Great. So we're here in beautiful Salzburg for the ISC conference, and for you it's quite a special one. You were awarded the Pregl Medal, and you joined quite an esteemed list of people. Can you tell me a little bit about your reaction to the medal and some of the reasons why you think that's so important?
Well, receiving awards when you're becoming old is not a real problem, but the Pregl Medal is something special because he was Nobel Prize winner.
Yep.
I think it was in 1923. And he received the Nobel Prize for miniaturization, in fact, of elemental analysis.
Right.
So he was bringing the sample size down to the milligram range.
Right.
Which was an exceptional at that time. And what is also special on these Pregl Medal is he started somewhere in the 50s, and it has only been given 20 times.
Wow.
So it's not a regular award and so on, yeah. And if I look to the list, well, in 85, A.G.P. Morton received that medal. And you know that A.G.P. Morton was the Nobel Prize winner for chromatography.
Yeah.
And I remember also very well in my career, in 85, I was invited in Italy by a symposium by Professor Liberti and Brunner.
Right.
They organized a meeting to honor A.G.P. Morton.
Right.
And at that time, I was 38 years old, but for unknown reason, I was invited to give lectures.
Really? Can you remember what the lecture was on?
Yeah, yeah. And the lecture was on capillary gas chromatography, on miniaturization of the column.
Right.
And it was amazed who was there, because also A.G.P. Morton was giving a lecture and all. At that time, the popes of chromatography were there. And one of the speakers was Erika Kramer.
Right.
And Erika was also professor at the University of Innsbruck. And in fact, if I look back to the history, and you can also check that, Erika was the first to perform a GC analysis. But she never received the Nobel Prize as A.G.P. Morton did.
Why do you think that was?
Because she submitted a paper, but the publishing house was destroyed during the war.
Oh, my. Goodness.
So the paper was only published 30 years after submitting the paper.
That's a long turnaround time.
And even at that meeting, A.G.P. Morton was very correct. He told to Erika we should have been receiving the award or the Nobel Prize together.
Yeah.
So, and for that reason, of course, it is something special. The Pregl Medal is something special. And also, yeah, Austria is extremely well known for a number of chromatographers. Joseph Huber, who was in fact also one of the pioneers of modern liquid chromatography, together with Csaba Horváth. And on today, you have Wolfgang Lindner, you have Hunter Bond, so a lot of very famous chromatographers have been born in Austria.
Sure. And why do you think you were put on this list? What is it that you think that you've... Is it just a very long career of many, many developments, or was there one thing that you feel that you've given to the community?
I really don't know, but I think a little bit one of my advantages was that I had to solve problems. So in order to solve problems, I had to be active in all fields.
Right.
So I didn't only publish in gas chromatography, in liquid chromatography, but also in supercritical fluid chromatography. I even wrote a book on capillary electrophoresis. I think that this being very broad in chromatography and also in mass spectroscopy, also different fields. I published papers on essential oil analysis, on perfumes, on biomolecules. So
sure.
I think this is one of the reasons.
So you, actually, that gives you a really big picture view of the whole
analytical
space, right? Which is probably why I noticed, and we published a feature on sample preparation and how that's a problem.
Mm-hmm.
But when you gave your lecture and said, you know, sample preparation is a problem, what are we doing? That's because you can see from so many fields that it's a problem in all of those fields, right?
It is definitely a problem, and it's still an underestimated problem, and it's by a lot of groups and disciplines not considered important. But if you don't have good sample and good sample preparation, all your data are wrong.
Exactly.
And it's still amazing that people are buying an instrument of €500,000, and then if they have to spend €20,000 on sample preparation, it's too much, you know?
Mm.
So the time of doing manual extractions of 1 liter of whatever material with 100 milliliters of solvent, that's over, you know?
Mm.
And so I still think that sample preparation on all meetings should be special sessions and discussions in detail because it's so important.
And it's come up certainly on a number of topics in the lectures at ISC. Have you seen any presentations at ISC that have really kind of thought, yeah, this is the right way of thinking?
Not specific, but what I feel is that everybody agrees that we must go more to automation and sample preparation.
Right.
And that I'm also very happy that the mentality is changing.
Yeah.
That people start really to talk about sample preparation. That's a very important issue. Mm. 5 years ago, nobody was talking about sample preparation. And even today, if we look to straightforward, so-called straightforward methods, like questions, that's not a straightforward method. It is a very good method, but you see on most publications, a modified questions method.
Yeah,
but if all the papers are the modified questions method, it's not a universal applicable method.
Right.
And that's good because people start to think, yeah, there is something we have to take more care of.
Mm. So, I mean, that's one of the kind of challenges that you speak out on quite a lot. What are the other things that kind of annoy you within the field? Are there any other kind of issues that you think need more attention or need to be solved more quickly?
It's not only my concern, but it's also a little bit my frustration that after being so long in the field, that the know-how and the knowledge is going down. So.
From an education point of view.
Yeah, well, it's the fundamentals of chromatography are very well known by most of the people attending meetings, but in the field it's just unbelievable how low the knowledge is on the basic principles of chromatography.
Right.
It's not so unusual that somebody is phoning me working already 10 years on liquid chromatography and he has a problem, and then I ask him, what are you doing? And then he say, well, this and this and this and this. And I say, well, why not using normal phase liquid chromatography? And very often the answer is, what is normal phase LC? Because the education at high schools and technical schools is nearly nihil in chromatography. Mm. And one of the reasons, of course, is also that education in chromatography is expensive. Eh? Mm. It's much easier to do a gravimetric analysis and titration than work with a GC mass spec or an LC system. Eh?
So what's the solution to that? Because obviously, from an instrumental point of view, one of the aims is to make it more accessible and easier to use. So is it just that we need to educate people moving into that field so that they've got that awareness? Or, I mean, is it purely an education problem, or do we need to address it in different directions? What's the kind of...
We should reintroduce it, and it's definitely a mature technique, but you have to know the fundamentals. Definitely, if you like to develop methods. And that's also the reason why in a quality control, quality assurance environment, it's nearly impossible to introduce a simple mass spec.
Mm.
And this should change, because sooner or later they will require that you also look with mass spec to those things.
Mm.
So it's a fundamental change of mentality.
Yeah. So we've discussed some of the big challenges. Where do you see the real bright lights of the future? What are the things that you think are going to move the field in the right direction?
My personal view is that you have, of course, different things in separation sciences, but what we are doing today is very close to what I call the 100% that we can reach.
Right.
For example, if you look to gas chromatography nowadays, well, analytical gas chromatography, like we will use it in our laboratories, is very close to the limit of development.
Right.
We will have, of course, it will be easier, we will have more robust data, versatility will be better, but we cannot believe that something changing completely our world will be introduced. No,
yeah.
The fundamentals are there that we know.
Eh? So no more dramatic changes?
I'm sorry?
No more dramatic changes?
No,
in
my opinion, not.
Mm.
And you see that also in liquid chromatography. In fact, what is going now in liquid chromatography, we start to discuss now all these performances of all these different column formats.
Mm.
But that's good for quality assurance and quality control. But in research and development, like what we are doing in our metabolomic studies and in our biopharmaceutical studies, I need a good column.
Mm.
But if that good column is now giving me 10% more performance, my mass spectrometer is deciding about my data.
Mm.
So mass spectroscopy is becoming so important that I must have very good chromatography, whatever is very good, if it is core shell particles or normal porous particles. But the columns we have today are very, very good. And the platforms we made at RIC, for example, I don't like to change the platforms.
No.
Because if I change my platform every time that a new column is introduced on the market, I'm going bankrupt.
Yeah.
I must have a very, very versatile, universal platform that I can rely on. Of course, another field is that, and this is something I see in the future, we will go into the direction of miniaturization, but this miniaturization will never compete with the robust systems.
Right.
The good thing of miniaturization is that we will go to a type of sensor systems.
Right.
For example, for personal medicine, for air pollution, all such things can be miniaturized. But we can never say, for example, I will miniaturize to such an extent that I will analyze 2,000 lipids in a sample.
Right.
You know, because then we need really the very important big machines. Yeah?
Right. I think the possibility drive is more for fairly niche applications, right? Where there's a clear need and it can be addressed with miniaturization.
Yeah.
And in terms of your kind of goals, currently, I know you describe yourself as retired, but not really, it seems. I see you at many conferences and always pushing the boundaries. But what kind of goals are you hoping to achieve, you know, in the next few years? Do you have some objectives that you've yet to fulfill?
Yeah, well, first of all, I'm a little bit egocentric or egoistic on this respect. I'm learning a lot of new things myself because, by definition, I was not at all a biochemist, so I was spending a lot of time to enter in the field of biochemistry. And I'm lucky that my son is a biochemist, so he is trying to explain me what is important and not important.
Right.
And also, one of my tasks is introducing chromatography in the other fields of research, because it's not that recently that chromatography and mass spectroscopy are at a relatively high level in bio and in life sciences. Because I remember 10 years ago, if in life sciences you were talking about GLP and GMP and reproducibility and repeatability, this was not at all keywords in the life science area.
Right.
So, but now with all the new developments, we really have to take care of all these regulated things as well. Yeah.
Which also comes back to the, you know, platforms being robust and reproducible, right? Yeah.
Well, if you can drastically enhance them, that's no discussion.
Yeah.
But for example, now we are discussing, it's important for quality assurance and quality control. If you can do it a little bit better and you can do it a little bit faster, let's say that you can do it in half of the time, this is important. But in pure research and development, I have some data, for example, that we evaluated for lipidomics all the different columns. And every time there is a column, we do some experiments to see in our platform, is it now improving or not?
Right.
But the mass spectrometer is deciding about that.
Right.
So if I increase my efficiency even with 20% in what is before the mass spectrum, I never see that, because we always have to realize that in chromatography, the gain in efficiency in the column is only in the resolution, the square root of that.
Right.
So the square root is definitely not that high. Eh?
Right. Finally, you've been at the conference, I think, most of the week. Is there anything that you've seen at ISC that you've thought is particularly inspirational, or any discussions that have come up that you've thought this is something new, this is a new hot topic?
I wonder tonight, I'm in a discussion session of supercritical fluid chromatography.
Right.
And this can be very lively, because I have to tell the truth that supercritical fluid chromatography is a non-existing technique. So this is something that is most probably will be the highlight of the meeting.
Right.
So I do not discuss the quality of CO2 as a mobile phase, but of course it's never under supercritical conditions. And my main concern is that if you educate the people in supercritical fluid chromatography as it is today, and it is not supercritical fluid chromatography, then as teachers, we are doing a very bad job.
Right. Yeah?
If you talk about all the possibilities and all the limitations of carbon dioxide, that's another story.
Yeah.
But first give the theory of a supercritical fluid and then say, okay, now we will use that, but we don't use that, is not helping the young generation to understand the theory.
Sure. Well, thank you very much for your time, Pat. It's been a pleasure talking to you, as always, always enlightening. So thank you very much for your time.
And you're welcome,
enjoy the discussion.
Okay, later. Thanks.
And please have some tea.